you know, this is the story of a divided population, right? Because there's a diaspora of Cubans, and then there are the Cubans who are on the island, and the struggle is to be able to move, right? To move through the strait, right? To come back and forth freely, and that's what is denied up to now. So I don't know if any of this answers your questions, but that's what came to mind.
No, but just, you know, I just wanted to talk about it and get a better perception, because also for me it's, you know, learning about how you're processing and how you're working. Because one of the things I felt like, I mean, for me, these characters is kind of challenging some of these feminist positions that are not really enough talked about. We have certain discourses that have been set and not challenged, and I think especially with, well, I think it's over the decades really, but in terms of looking at this generation, what now they are informed with new questions, and when they are coming together and discussing, there are new conflicts about certain, you know, confrontations about different experiences, what it is to be, you know, feminist, what is our role, what is our position, what is our responsibility. And one of the things, it seems like, you know, almost like how to make the message pass to an audience. And thinking about language or poetry or unlearning, the process of unlearning. But also, is there a necessity to reenact violence also? Because, you know, some of the situations are based, they're not just a reflection, but they're a direct commentary on how the system works. And some of these, I felt some of these characters are quite, you know, like, and I thought, is maybe I'm
there, well, I don't know, no, I don't know, like, what are they?
I feel that some of these characters are reenacting this violence. And do we need to...
You mean my performance characters?
Yes. And do we need
the
to...
The world is full of violence. The world is full of violence. History is full of violence. Daily life is full of violence. You know, I'm not going to turn my back on what happens in the world. The world is full of violence. If I wanted to paint flowers, I would be a different person. You know, I have colleagues who paint flowers, do landscapes. I don't tell them not to do it. I tell them if that's what makes you happy, then go. You know, I paint your flowers. You know, that's not what moves me to work. You know, and when I was in college a long time ago, 35 years ago, I wrote a feminist thesis. You know, I read my feminist books. You know, and I did all of that. And when I was in graduate school, I also wrote a feminist thesis about psychoanalysis when I was doing my master's. And I read my books and I did what I had to do. Right? I'm living in a country where they're about to make abortion illegal. Okay. Where women make 60 some cents on the dollar for men, where there are hardly any women with permanent faculty positions in my field, in academia, where, you know, people in Congress are talking about women as hosts for fetuses. I really, it's just so crystal clear to me that the reality of kind of of gender inequality, it's so palpable. I don't really feel like painting flowers is going to satisfy my need to respond to reality. And so I don't worry about that. In the 70s, there was a momentary feminist debate about whether or not it was a good idea for feminists to reproduce scenarios that were oppressive to women. So should women artists reproduce sex scenes or rape scenes or, you know, this, but that was an argument in the 1970s when I was in high school. I don't think at this point in time I need to worry about the arguments that were circulating when I was in high school and that defined a very different moment. I'm more concerned about turning my back on very harsh realities that affect the majority of women in the world. And, you know, in the 20 some years ago when people were all crazy about the internet and seeing it as, you know, this glorious paradise, and I said, well, what about all the women who are getting paid 3 cents an hour to make your cell phones and your computer monitors? And a lot of people were like, oh, you're such a downer and you don't really want to understand the digital revolution and, you know, and they just wanted to turn back on the exploitative global labor relations that were totally oppressive to women workers outside of Europe and the United States, because they wanted to revel in the joy of their new electronic toys. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted to talk about the situation of women in the assembly line who were making the technology that everybody was using in Europe and the United States. And a lot of people didn't like me for it. Too bad.
But you also, yeah.
I don't care. You know, I don't do this stuff to be liked.
You're talking about a specific, also a specific audience. I'm just saying that this idea of reenactment, like in terms of where we do it, who is there to share with us? How are people responding? Not everybody will perceive it in the same way. So this idea of like, it can be, well, when I say reenacting, violence, there are certain things, for example, that would have happened to my community or to myself, that I wouldn't want to reenact that violence. I would do it in a specific way. I would get shit from my community to say, why are you repeating this violence? So that's why.
Well, you know what that reminds me of?
Yes.
My very conservative mother, who was very upset when I wanted to work on sex tourism in Cuba, because it was so, why did I have to show the unpleasant things about Cuba? Why couldn't I tell people the good things about Cuba? And it reminds me of the Latin American high bourgeoisie that, you know, hated when I came to South America caged as an Amerindian because I was showing unattractive things about Latin America, and that I should only show that, you know, this is like the positive negative image argument, which is also part of the kind of 1970s proto post-colonial discourse. I'm not going to cooperate with that kind of self-censorship. I don't want to do it. I don't have a specific community. I operate in many communities, and, you know, if I'm looking for acceptance from Cuban exiles, I'm never going to get it. So, if I'm looking for acceptance from all women, I'm never going to get that.
So we're looking for acceptance, but we're looking at how we learn from these responses. What did you learn from?
From my mother.
How did your perception of looking at making things also? Because you will always change. You can never take one direction and stick with it. In terms of the responses, you're going involved with it because of how you've been interacting with the audience. So can you have any memories of these major turns of responses?
Sure. I mean, there have been plenty of times when I've gotten in trouble, or when authorities haven't wanted me to do things, or when somebody hasn't liked it. It's the same in the classroom. You know, I have a lot of students who get angry at me or don't like having to work or whatever, and then they write me 10 years later and they're like, oh, I still remember what I learned in your class, and thank you so much, you know. And these were the kids who were giving me hell, you know, 10 years before, and then they change over time. You know, they mature and they think more about what I was trying to do with them, and they think maybe it wasn't so bad. And the same with audiences. You know, some audiences understand one thing in the moment, and then a day later they understand a different thing, and 5 years later they understand a different thing. But, you know, I don't control, I am not seeking to control what people think about me, and I cannot control what they experience about my art. I can't. And if I focus on that, then I think I'm focusing on something that is impossible. Because I cannot control how others feel. I can only offer things to the world and hope that somebody will get something from it. But I cannot control, and I don't want to control, what people feel about me. I want them to decide and deal with it and leave it there. And I think that that's a more respectful position than hiding things from people or censoring myself, you know, out of fear. Or if I wanted to do that, I would go work in a bank. You know, and then I couldn't wear my hair this way, and I would have to, you know, wear a skirt, and I'd have to wear heels, and I'd have to repress myself in ways that I don't have to because of the career choice that I made, right? So if I'm honest with myself about the professional choices I've made and the decision to be an artist, and I want to be free to do what I want to do, and let others be free to think what they want to think.
I'm gonna round it up now with one last question. This is more to do with the current research that you're doing, so you can talk more. terms of the practice of researching archives, for you, do you think, how can it help in any way push social shifts on local politics? How can the sort of looking at archives and putting into practice somehow, transforming this material, think about posing new questions in terms of our current politics?
Well, I'm not always making things to change local politics, because I do move around a lot. And right now, you know, I actually spent part of my time living in New York, part of my time living in Florida, part of my time going to Cuba. So the local for me is so confused. I don't even know what local is for me anymore. But I can give you an example. You know, when Guillermo Gomez Peña and I started working on the Caged Amerindian performance, which did require a lot of research into the history of the ethnographic display, there had been some academics who had done some work on this. There was some mention, some kind of cultural historians had looked at ethnographic displays in world fairs, some anthropologists had done a little bit of work on this kind of thing as well. But it wasn't a systematic study. There wasn't a systematic study, and there certainly wasn't a focus on this in theater study, performance study, or art study, which is really where we were operating at all. The idea of interculturalism in performance studies that was popular at that time was more coming out of like Victor Turner and Richard Schechner's theories of performance, and it was really about, you know, absorbing grand non-Western cultural traditions from India, or, you know, spiritually dance from different West African countries, etc. It was about this kind of Benetton-like concept of sharing all of the great cultural traditions of the world, and, you know, the great white theorists would run off and join whatever religion in India for a while and then come back and write books about it. That was interculturalism when I was in my 20s. And, you know, we were proposing with our research and with our artwork a different trajectory, a different historical trajectory that had to do with involuntary performances, with people, indigenous people being brought to Europe against their will and brought